In this video, we'll explain how to get a data source into WeWeb, because it's awesome to build user interfaces with WeWeb. Obviously, we think so, but user interfaces really come to life when you add data and user interactions. So we'd like to make sure that you have data in your project already before we start the design, so you understand how it works right from the get-go. So in WeWeb, you have plugins. You can find the plugins here in this little with this little puzzle icons. And you have data source plugins. You have native integrations like Airtable, Xano, Supabase. But you also have plugins that you can use with multiple sources. So a REST API plugin, you can connect an SQL database. Like, we even have a SOAP API plugin. You can connect Algolia, GraphQL, even Google Sheets if you want to. So that's how data source, where you can find data source plugins in WeWeb. And for future reference, if you need to add authentication, it will be the same. It's in the plugins. You have the authentication plugins here. So native integrations like Xano, Supabase, and Auth0. But also, if you need to, but we'll cover that in the, you know, in the courses on how to scale and a web app and how to improve performances and connect with more advanced elements and plugins. If you have a token-based auth, you can use this plugin. Then you have a bunch of other extensions, but really that's a topic for another video. So let's focus on the data sources. In this case, what we all you have to do really, if you want to add a data source, if you want to connect Airtable, for example, you click on here, then you'll have a configuration where you will be invited to add your API key. And you have instructions, you usually have instructions here on the right panel to help you with that. So if you wanted to add maybe the Xano plugin, then you have a configuration here as well where you're invited to add your API key and connect to it. We'll work with the REST API. So let me first remove the plugin so you know what it looks like when there is no REST API plugin. So here we go. We go to plugins, data sources, REST API, and we will add it now. Now we want to add a collection. Once you've added a data source plugin, once you've configured a data source, and we have dedicated videos to explain how to connect to Airtable, how to connect to Xano, how to connect to Supabase, all of that, you have dedicated videos. But once you've added your data source, your plugin, you'll want to add a collection of data. So here we go to add collection. We'll call it, let's go ahead, it will be calls. And the source is our REST API. For an MVP and for a web app, we recommend using the dynamic mode. You have static and cache modes. These are for more advanced use cases. So you might use static if you want to host your blog on WeWeb. We wouldn't necessarily recommend that because our tool is more focused on web apps, but you could do it. You might need to cache your data if at some points for some advanced use cases, you might need that. But we'll focus on the web app that scales use case and with a dynamic collection. When you use the dynamic mode, your data never goes through our server. So that can be very important depending on the project you're working on. Basically, what happens when you use the dynamic collection is that we just make the API call. And as a builder in WeWeb or the end user using your app, the data is sent to the user's browser, but it never transits through a WeWeb server. For your information, WeWeb servers are on AWS in the United States. So that's something that may or may not be important to you. In any case, we recommend choosing the dynamic mode. Unless you know exactly what you're doing and you want specifically static or cached data. Let's click on continue. And here, if you're familiar with APIs, you will recognize these settings. You can choose a different method of getting data, basically of interacting with the API you're interacting with. In this case, we want to get data from the API, so we'll choose the get query. And again, we have dedicated lessons on working with APIs. The purpose of this video is really to show you how to get the data into WeWeb. All right, so here what we'll want to do is we'll want to add an endpoint, the API endpoint, that will send us the data. In this case, we're using a Xano backend, so we'll just paste the endpoint that we need. This will really depend on the API you're working with, and What we'll do is we'll get, what we want to get is all the calls here. If I click continue, this will get my data. So this was get a list of calls. And what's interesting is that if you disable the formatted text here, you see that this is what the data, you see all the objects, all the data that is sent by the REST API. So here, if you're familiar with some development terms, this is an array or list, depending on the language you're working with, the programming language you're working in. It's a list or array of objects. Now, you don't need to know all about this right now. If you're just a beginner, that's absolutely fine. Just think of it of like the 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, all the way to 999. Those are items. Those are indexes. So it's indexes in a list that say, okay, item 3 is this particular object. And now think of an Airtable database, so a table. Or you can even think of a spreadsheet if that helps. But the idea is in the table of your database, you have columns and you have rows. So the 0, 1, 2, 3, all the way to 999, those are your rows. Those are the rows in your table. And then inside those rows, you have values. And the values are would be all the purple and yellow here, the 28, the phone number, the timestamp here. Those are the values. And in blue here, ID, call to, date, duration, all of these are the name of your columns. So 0 is one row, and those are the values in the corresponding ID, call to, date, duration, user ID, and type columns of the table in your Airtable or Xano or Supabase table. Okay, so that's important to understand, like how the data is structured, how it's formatted, because it's a standard format, a structured data. That's how basically different products are able to communicate among themselves on the internet through APIs because of that structured data. It doesn't matter if you're writing JavaScript or Python or using a no-code tool that abstracts both these languages or either of these languages, you will be able to communicate with the rest of the internet through structured data. Okay, now that you have fetched the data, you see here we fetch the data. This is the step in WeWeb where we fetch the data. And you see that afterwards, if I click continue, I can filter my calls. So for example, I could say, I only want calls where the duration is less than, let's say, 1,000 minutes. So if I save and test here, instead of having 999 objects, I only have 134. So actually 135 because I started index 0. And that's something else to keep in mind is that in programming, the first item is always 0. It's important we chose at WeWeb to respect that programming convention because as you scale your apps, you're going to, you know, we like the idea of following programming best practices so that you don't have what you learn in WeWeb, you can transfer those skills into other tools that are also close to the code or to code itself if you need to, if at some point you want to learn JavaScript or whatever, or if you already know JavaScript, if you want to use it. In any case, when you filter the data here, what's important to understand is that this is called a front-end filter. So the data is filtered in the front end, in the user's browser. So the 1,000 objects we had before from index 0 to index 999, those are in your user's browser, but they might not be able to see them on the page because you filtered them in the front end. But if they know what they're doing, they might look for them in the user's browser. This is important for data privacy and security reasons. Again, we have dedicated videos on the topic, but the idea is that if you want to keep the data private, if there is personal information that you do not want anyone to be able to access, you should add the filter at the backend level, not on the front end, because front end filters, this is not a peculiarity of WeWeb. It's a web development thing. Front end filters mean that, you know, will not prevent the data from being in your user's browser. So let's go ahead and click done. And on our page, we have a table, and what we can do here is that we can, what we call, bind the items. So we have a collection of calls. This is what we just added. We can bind this. And suddenly, once we do this, you will see that we have this is repeated many times. And it will become clear. Then we can, inside this flex box, there's a text element, so we can bind this to, let's say, the duration of minutes in our table. So that's how you get data into WeWeb and onto the page. So a few things careful about. So a few things to remember. Let's say you can connect multiple data sources to the same project. So in this project, we have data collections from Airtable, from a REST API plugin, and also from Xano here. This is one thing. Secondly, when if you add a filter after the data is fetched by the front end, this will not prevent users from finding the data in the browser. So for example, if we go ahead here, I'm reloading the page to fetch the collection. There we go. And here I can actually go ahead. You see calls, that's the name I gave my collection. And you see here, I have all those items. I have the 1000 items. So even though on the page, I only have 134, in my browser, I can actually find the 1000 items. And it may not be a big deal, or it might be a big deal. If you load too much data into the browser will crash. So if you're working in the WeWeb editor and you're trying to load thousands of items in WeWeb, the browser might crash. And this will not be because of WeWeb. It will just be because the data that you downloaded, basically that your browser downloaded to be able to work with it, it will have been too big, and the browser will just not like it and crash. So one good way to think about that, to avoid loading too much data, is to think about your user's mobile data plans. Just think about the fact that whenever you load a lot of data, the user's browser will slow down. It might not crash, but it will slow down. You've all experienced it. Loading a web page that takes a long, long time. That's because the browser is actually downloading a bunch of files that needs to display the information. So if you put yourself in the shoes of the end user and think about someone who might be in a place where they don't have high-speed internet, they only have maybe 3G or 4G, and maybe they don't have a big data plan, maybe they only have 1 gigabyte or even less on their mobile data plan, be conscious that there are users out there, and that you want them to be able to use your app, basically. All right, that's it. That's how you add a set of data to your WeWeb projects. If you wish to learn how to work with a specific data source plugin like Xano or Airtable, Superbase, or whatever, I recommend you go ahead and look at the dedicated video on that particular plugin, or read the specific article on that data source plugin on the user documentation at docs.weweb.io.